So, welcome to Numerical Methods for Mathematical Finance. So we will have a session on computer arithmetic now. And I believe it is also important because the stuff that you will see today and tomorrow is to some extent very simple, very trivial. But if you do not know it, it can happen that you write a computer program which looks from a mathematical side perfectly okay, but which produces just bad results or nonsense because the numerics doesn't work. The numerics may look as if works as it if works from the mathematical side, but there is some issue that the mathematical operators are actually not represented by the operators you use in your computer program. And when I use operators, the word operators, I refer to simple things like plus or minus. Okay, so let's start with this. Yeah, and I like to stress that it's quite important. I have feedback from old students that use this in their work, and actually, it saved some time that they know how this works. I can do it only very briefly, but I will give you a link where you can read more about this. So feel free and also to contact us on this. So we will start by looking at how the computers actually represents numbers. So what is the issue here with computer arithmetic? So a high-level programming language usually hides the details of how the computer actually calculates the result from us. And so we are not aware of what is going on underneath, yeah, if we write x plus y. Yeah? But this is actually an issue because if you are not aware, you don't know that some operations behave differently in some areas. I will actually focus on the floating point numbers. Oops. So we will focus on the floating point numbers. And what I discuss here is this IEEE 754 standard. So if you like to read a little bit about this, you could Google maybe IEEE 754. And this is actually what is used in maybe most or all modern programming languages like C++, C#, Java, Scala, and also in frameworks like MATLAB, Mathematica, etc. Yeah. So I will focus on floating point numbers, but I will start a first small session on integers because you already see something when you look at integers. So an integer number is actually just a subset of the set Z, okay? Namely some fixed interval, all the values from some minimum integer value up to some maximum integer value. When we have 32 bits, we can represent in binary form 2 to the power of 32 numbers. Yeah, this is approximately 4 billion. And well, let's split these numbers to 2 equal halves, the negative numbers, let's use minus 2 to the power of 31 negative numbers. And then we also need the zero. Yeah. So we have one additional number, the zero. So we have 2 to the power of 31 minus 1 numbers left, which we use for the positive numbers. Okay. So we have 2 to the power of 32 numbers, which we can use. And if we choose the minimum value and the maximum value accordingly, then these numbers go from minus 2 to the power of 31, 2 to the power of 31 plus minus, minus 2 to the power of 31 plus 1, and so on, minus 1, 0, 1, and so on, 2 to the power of 31 minus 1 is the last one. And now I have a question. What actually happens if I take this last number here and add 1 to it? So what do we get? Do we get an error? Yes or no? So maybe you can vote on the buttons if you like. Yeah. Do we get an error? Yes or no? Okay. So now I see 6 people say, yes, we get an error. 11 say no. But if we do not get an error, what do we get? Let's just try it out. Okay, so I go to Eclipse. I create some new class file. Let's take here a new class file where I like to do my experiment. So I call this now Computer Arithmetic Experiment. Let's create a main method so I can run some program. Yeah, so I can run some test. Oh, let's make it a little bit larger so you see better. And let's try this out. So I create an integer, let's say I, yeah? And I call this I should be the max value. Yeah? So you see here in Java, integer provides this value, integer max value, a constant holding the maximum value int, which is 2 to the power of 31 minus 1. Okay, so we get this value. So let's define another one, which is I plus 1, and this should be the result of the operation I plus 1. So, and then let's print. I is equal to the value of I, and I plus 1 is equal to the value of I plus 1. Okay, so let's print, let's run. And what we see is I is this largest possible number, and I plus 1 is actually minus 2 to the power of 31. Okay, so the surprising, or maybe not surprising for some of you, but the thing which you have to be aware of is that if I now do a test, is I larger than I plus 1? So let's do this test. I larger than I plus 1. Yeah, so you know this here is just a string, and this here is a logical operation. I compare two numbers. The result is a Boolean, so it should print the Boolean value of this test. And this is true. Yeah? So I larger than I plus 1 is true. Okay. So, question, what happens if I is the maximum value and we add 1 to it? Answer, we get the minimum value. So what we draw from this is, oops, it's important to understand how these operators work, at least at these boundary values. Of course, maybe some have already understood what's going on here. Yes, and some have the right suggestion, yeah? But the none is not the right answer. Okay, so some have maybe already understood what's going on here. Yeah, our numbers are on a line. There's 0, there's one, there's minus one. And if we go to the maximum value, we reach the maximum value. This is here. And if we go to the minimum value, we reach the minimum value, which is here. And this forms a circle. Okay, actually, the integer numbers form an equivalence class with some modulus operation. Yeah. And if we perform some operation, an addition or a subtraction, we just run around this circle. Okay, we can also express this a little bit more in mathematical terms. Yeah. So if I denotes the set of integers and G is some operator on Z squared and mapping to Z, yeah, then this G is the mathematical operator. Oops. So this G here is the mathematical operator. This is associated with some G tilde, which is the representation of this operator in the integer arithmetics. So this is the implementation. Of G within the integer arithmetic. And you see that G and G tilde may differ by some constant, which is a multiple of 2 to the power of 32. Now, put differently, we can write that G tilde is G modulus 2 to the power of 32. Now, I didn't start in 0, yeah, so there is some shift, but actually it's a kind of modulus operation. Okay, so that was my small session on integer arithmetic, and maybe you believe that you will never reach this point, yeah, where you jump over from the maximum to the minimum. But if you look in the chat, it looks like Andrea already observed this. And this is just maybe one example where you have to be aware of how actually these operations work. And I have much more frightening examples for the real numbers. So for the real numbers, well, actually, we cannot represent the real numbers in the computer. Yeah. So we cannot even represent the rational numbers, because you saw that I can only represent a subset of integers, so a subset of Z by integers. So how could I expect that I can represent the rational numbers? Instead, we will have a subset of the rational numbers, and this subset, I call it, or it is called, the floating point numbers. So we will discuss now the floating point numbers, and these floating point numbers are actually encoded by three integers, S, C, and E. Oops. So, three integers. So there's S, which we will use to encode the sign. So S is either 0 or 1 if the number is positive or negative. Yeah, so we need one bit for this, on or off, to encode the sign. Then the number C is between some lower bound, which is zero, which is included, and some upper bound, which is 2 to the power of some p, which is not included, and we need p bits for this. Yeah. So for example, if p equals 2, then I can represent the numbers c is 0, 1, 2, or 3. Okay, I can represent 2 to the power of 2, 4 different numbers, c. And then we have some e, and this e is in between an e max and an e min, which we will choose later. But we will use our bits. So we can represent 2 to the power of r. So if I like to have e, an integer between e min and e max, it has to be that the length of this interval, so e max minus e min, and since I also include both endpoints, plus 1, is equal to 2 to the power of r. Okay, so this is now a set of integers, and maybe if you have 1 bit, p bit, and r bits, it should be that 1 plus p plus r is something nice, like, for example, say 32 bits or 64 bits, but could also be implemented in different form. So we will use these three integers now to construct a set which approximates the real numbers, a q. Yeah? So approximates in a very weak sense. Okay, and this set contains the so-called normalized floating point numbers. So intention here, there is contains, yeah, the normalized floating point numbers. So the normalized floating point numbers are just a subset. So the normalized floating point numbers is the set where E is a little bit more restricted to be in between E max not included and E min not included. So just at this point, be aware that we still have 2 choices for E left. Okay, so how do the normalized floating point numbers look like? So our definition is here. Yeah. So the normalized floating point number is constructed using s to encode the sign, so minus 1 to the power of s. Then I use c to construct a number between 1 and 2. Yeah, so 1 plus c divided by 2 to the power of p. If you know that c is between 0 and 2 to the power of p, is a number in the interval of 1, between 1 and 2. Yeah, 1 included, 2 not included. So I have something like 1.0, 1 point something else, but I do not have 2.0. If I like to have 2.0, then I have to multiply with 2. So I have to choose E for this. E is actually encoding the magnitude with respect to multiplication with 2. Okay, so maybe I just answer your question. Okay, so now I have constructed the normalized floating point number. No? So this 2 to the power of e is somehow creating the magnitude of this. Yeah. So this guy is, for example, a 1. Then I have something like 1.0 to 2. Yeah. It can be a 2. Yeah. Then I have something like 2.0, 2 point something else, up to 3, but 3, up to 4, but not included, yeah, because I multiply with 2. Yeah. Then it's 4, 8, and so on. Oops, what happened? Okay. I can also shrink the magnitude, yeah, to 1/2, 1/4, and so on. Okay, so maybe I assume I make a small drawing here. That, for example, the minimum e-min is minus 1. Then, since e is larger than e-min, e is 0, 1, 2, and so on. And also, maybe we assume that p is equal to 2. Yeah. So p somehow defines the resolution here. Of this part, c divided by 2 to the power of p. Yeah. So then I can have the different values. C is equal to 0, 1, 2, or 3. Yeah. 2 to the power of p is 2 to the power of p is the upper bound for c. Yeah, not included. Yeah, so it's smaller than 4. Okay, so if I assume this, so maybe then I can draw a few of these numbers. Yeah, so we have say 0 here. Okay, and the first number that I can represent is s equals 0, z equals 0. E equals 0. Yeah, 2 to the power of 0 is 1. Then if I place E to be equal to 1, I have, oops, maybe this is on the scale here a bit too far left. So let's draw it here. Yeah. So here I have the 2. Yeah. So which is E equals 1, C equals 0, S also equals 0. Then E equals 2, 2 to the power of 2 is 4, which is somewhere here. And then the 8 is somewhere here. Yeah, so this is E equals 2, E equals 3. Okay. So these are the numbers where C is equal to 0. So maybe this is just the part that is created by E. So maybe I draw them in green here, which is the part created by E. So now I allow for different values of C. Yeah. So now I allow for different values of C. C equals 0 is already used. So I have 1, 2, 3. 2 divides it in the middle. 1 divides it here. 3 divides it here. So this is how these numbers are created. Yeah. So we have different intervals. which become larger and larger. So this is controlled by the parameter E. Yeah. So the parameter E somehow tells us about the magnitude of the number. Is it a large number or is it a small number? And then we have C, which does an equidistributed discretization of this interval inside. Okay. So we have, of course, also S, which creates us the same for the negative values. Okay. So I have some numbers also here. But a funny thing is that zero is not in this set. This is not part of our floating point numbers. So zero is missing. And since zero is maybe an important number, we have to fix this. But before we fix this, let's take a small look again at these numbers. So the normalized floating point numbers have a nice property. If you take a look at two neighboring numbers, say for example here, one plus C divided by 2P multiplied with some 2 to the power of E. So the magnitude of the two numbers is the same, but they are just two neighboring numbers. Okay, so if you then calculate the relative error, x2 minus x1 divided by x1, so the relative distance, then x2 minus x1 divided by x1, this is 1 plus c divided by 2p times 2 to the power of e, so this is a c plus 1 here, minus 1 plus c divided by 2p, 2 to the power of e, divided by 2 to the power of e, you see this cancels, times 1 plus c divided by 2p. Okay, so you see that this is just 1 divided by 2p, divided by a number between 1 and 2. Yeah? 1 included, 2 not included. So actually this is in the interval of 1 divided by 2p plus 1, not included, and 1 divided by 2p. So maybe I remove this ugly calculation here. From this, we can conclude actually something. So if you have some calculation and you need to round to the next number, then you have a rounding error. Okay. So what is the distance from your rounded result to the true result? Actually, the distance is the half of this, yeah? Because you are in an interval, you have a result. These are the two numbers which are actually now represented by the normalized floating point numbers. You have a result in between, and the distance to the next number is the half of the size of this interval. And we have just shown here that the size of this interval is smaller than 1 divided by 2p. So we have an upper bound on the relative error, yeah, the relative error. So the word relative here is important, comes from the fact that I divide by the number itself, yeah, the relative error, when rounding to to the next floating point number. Okay. So that was my little introduction of the normalized floating point numbers. But you saw here on this picture that zero, the interval around zero, is not part of this construction. So we need to construct the numbers around zero. Okay, these numbers are called the so-called denormalized floating point numbers. So let's construct the denormalized floating point numbers. So my floating point number x, well, what we had was the normalized floating point numbers. So it was, let's recall this, the sign, then something between 1 included, 2 not included, 1 plus c divided by 2p, and then some multiplicator, which is a power of 2, which moves the number to the right location. Okay, so we used this encoding if E was between E min and E max. Okay, so these were the normalized floating point numbers. Zero is not included. So zero is here, is not included. The smallest number I can represent, the smallest positive number I can represent, is s equals zero because it's positive, c equals zero because it should be the smallest one, and e equals e min plus one because e has to be larger than e min. So this here is the smallest number I can represent in the normalized numbers. Yeah? So what I can represent so far. So it is 2 to the power of e min plus 1. Yeah? So as I have drawn in this picture here, yeah, this is the smallest number we can currently represent. And then the next one here is 2 to the power of e min plus 2. And then the distance is getting larger. Yeah, so it's again multiplied with 2. 2 to the power of e min plus 3. And in between, we had this equidistribution. So these are the queen numbers, the normalized numbers. So the same on the negative side. On the negative side, the largest negative number I can represent here is minus 2 to the power of e min plus 1. Whoops. Okay. So what I do inside the interval from 0 to 2 to the e min plus 1 is just I use c to have an equidistributed discretization of this interval. Yeah? So I use c divided by 2p for e is equal to e min. So now c divided by 2p is a number between 0 included now and 1 not included. So I would like to be this on the right hand side, the smallest number I can represent with the normalized one. Yeah? So c is between 0 and 2 to the power of p, not included. So this number c divided by 2 to the power of p is between 0 included, 1 not included. Yeah? So now zero is included, then I have some equidistribution, but the one is not included because it's already the other set. And then we use the sign encoding the S to get the same on the negative side. Okay, so now we have constructed a set of numbers, and for this set of denormalized numbers, so here is the definition, we also have some properties. Well, so let's recap here. So E min is now fixed, and the number is minus 1 to the power of S C divided by 2P times 2 to the power of E min plus 1. And the zero is included, yeah. So maybe I make a few remarks here. So zero is included. Actually, there are two different zeros because there is a plus zero, which is S is zero, Z is zero, and E is equal to E min, yeah, which switches this encoding on. And there's a minus zero. S is one, Z is zero. So actually you can test in the computer if you have a plus zero or minus zero, but if you ask the computer is minus zero equal to plus zero, he will return true. This is sometimes an interesting thing, yeah? You can experiment with this a little bit. We have remarks on this later. If you like to see if something has converged to zero from the left or to the or from the right. Okay, so zero is included. If zero is included, looking at the relative error does not make a lot of sense. Yeah. So x2 minus x1 for two nearby numbers or whatever does not make sense if x1 may become zero. So the relative error will explode. Yeah, it will become infinity. It doesn't make a lot of sense, but you can look at the absolute distance. Yeah. So if x1 is a denormalized number, say minus 1 s times c divided by 2p to e min plus 1, and x2 is the next number, then we can tell something about the distance. Yeah, so the absolute distance, x2 minus x1, say, forget about the sign, is just 1 divided by 2p times 2 e min plus 1. Yeah, so this is 2 to the power of e min plus 1 minus p. So this is the smallest distance we can represent. Yeah? So this is the smallest difference between two numbers we can actually distinguish. Okay. So I have a small picture here on the denormalized floating point numbers. So now we have an equidistributed discretization between zero and this point where we flip to the other encoding of numbers. And if you recall that the normalized numbers, they used E between E min and E max, both not included. So now the denormalized numbers they use E equals to E min. Yeah, so if we take a look at the E and then we switch the interpretation, but then we still have left E equals to E max. Okay, so what's that? So what is E equals to E max? So we maybe could just add another set of of normalized numbers. Yeah. So have again normalized numbers on the scale of 2 to the power of E max. But actually, this is not what is done in this standard here. E equals E max is used for some special values. And one of these special values is the next largest number. So what is the next largest number? The next largest number would be S is equal to 0, C is equal to 0, and E is equal to 2 to the E max. This is what you get in terms of numbers if you add, or if you move to the next number from the last normalized floating point number we can represent. Yeah, the last floating point number we can represent in the normalized ones. Yeah, so let's just look at the positives. Is C is equal to 2 to the power of P minus 1, which is the last possible value for C. And then E is equal to 2 E max minus 1. Okay, so this is the last possible normalized number. This would be actually the next representation. And this number is called infinity. Okay, so in addition, the floating point numbers, so here, for example, in Java, the double, yeah, they can take some additional values. And these additional values are minus infinity and plus infinity, which is actually from the encoding, just the next normalized floating point number. So S equals 1 for the negative ones, S equals 0 for the positive ones, and then C equals 0 because it is the next number on the larger scale, and E equals E max, so it's the next scale. But these numbers have special rules. Yeah. So like infinity in mathematics has special rules. Yeah. 5 plus infinity is infinity. Infinity minus 5 is infinity. So looks like once you get into infinity, you never get back. Okay, and these rules somehow apply also here. I will have a section on infinity later. But you know, since C can take different values, there are even more possibilities now. And these possibilities here, which is C equal to 0, are used to encode not a number. Yeah. So not a number is some error, for example, the square root of a negative number. Yeah, will result in this code. So actually, this not a number is a bit pattern for the floating point number, and it is a valid result. Yeah. So like in the integer example, we do not get an exception, we do not get an error, we do not get an error message, we just get a value which represents something. And this represents something here is not a number. So maybe we can do some more experiments on this. And I like to conclude, yeah, so we have some 5 or 10 minutes left. I like to conclude with some computer experiment, but before we do some experiment on the computer, here's a summary. So I always talked about we have P, which is the resolution of the value which is between 1 and 2. This is the mantissa. So this is P, yeah? So this gives us C, which is between 0 and 2 to the power of P. And we have the exponent, yeah, which is encoded by our number R, yeah? And the number R was actually defining the range which was available for E min and E max. Okay. So, and now we can decide how many bits we like to distribute. If we have a floating point number with double precision, we have 64 bits available. And this standard uses, for example, 11 bits for the exponent. If you use 11 bit for the exponent, then Emax, sorry, where is this pen here? Emax can be 10 to the 1024, yeah, and emin is 1023, yeah. So that if I take the sum of the two, yeah, I have 2048, which is 2 to the power of 11, yeah, which I can encode with 11 bits. So actually one decided to have a little bit more room for the large numbers than for the small range numbers. So 2 to the power of 1024 is approximately something like 10 to the 300. So this is the resolution of these numbers, or 10 to the minus 300. Okay, so now let's do some small experiments and then we will have more interesting stuff tomorrow. Let's do a computer code session. We already had a look at the integer. What is actually integer maximum value plus one? So now let's have a look at the floating point numbers double. Yeah. So if this here is, say, some comment, explore integer. So now let's try and explore double. So maybe I print some new line here and I add some code to explore the floating point number double. So on my slides, there were two suggestions what we could do. What is the smallest positive non-zero value? So actually, let's try. I call this number maybe tiny. Yeah, it's the smallest positive non-zero value. We could maybe take a look at the double class, which has something like max value, min value. Yeah, but maybe let's try an experiment. I set this to one, tiny, to one, and then I would like to use this number and make it smaller and smaller again by dividing it by two, until it cannot be distinguished from zero. So while tiny divided by two is larger than two, divide tiny by two. Okay, so this is some loop. Actually, now the mathematician would think this loop runs forever, because you can make a number smaller and smaller, it will never hit zero if you started by one. Yeah, so you can divide a number by two and two again. It will never hit zero if you start by one. But okay, surprise, this loop will not run forever. It will stop at a certain point. And let's have a look at where it stops. Let's print this number. Okay, so let's run this program. And you see this number, this smallest number, which he can distinguish from a zero, is 5 times 10 to the minus 324. Yeah? So it's approximately this, where e is 2 to the power of 1023. And then we still had some range left with the p. Yeah? So it's a little bit more. Okay, so how does this number behave? What actually happens if I divide this number by 2? What do I get? Okay, so I would like to print tiny divided by 2. So tiny divided by 2 is 0. He cannot distinguish it from 0. Okay, so now let's be evil. What happens if I divide tiny by 2 and I multiply by 2 again? But of course, I divide first and then I multiply. Okay, this is 0. As a programmer, maybe you have expected this, but as a mathematician, it looks like an issue. Yeah, so if I first, let's write here times 1/2. So if I first divide by 2 and then multiply with 2, so I like to make this first. Oops. Oh, why is that? Okay, so there was some integer division. Yeah, sorry for that. So if I first take 1/2 times 2 and then I multiply with tiny, of course I get tiny again. So you see that some elementary rules of mathematics are violated here. Yeah. Okay. So there was another suggestion on the slides. Yeah. So maybe I still have a few minutes. We started a bit later and we had a break. So explore double part one. Part two was find the smallest positive number such that x and x plus 1 can be distinguished. Okay, so what does this mean? So let's start with some number epsilon and now make epsilon smaller and smaller again. So that 1 plus epsilon can be distinguished from 1. Ah, sorry, there's a typo in the script here. It should be that such that 1 and 1 plus x can be distinguished. So maybe I fix this here. Yeah? So this should be just 1. Okay. So this is what I like to do. Yeah. I like to find a small number and I ask myself, can you distinguish 1 from 1 plus 1? Okay. So let's make the number smaller. And then let's print what is epsilon. So what is epsilon? So since I wrote this loop like this, I'm testing 1 plus epsilon is larger than 1. So I'm testing this. If this is true, I divide. So I stop at the first point where this fails. Yeah. So actually, this epsilon, which we print now, is the first number which we cannot distinguish. For which we cannot distinguish 1 plus epsilon and 1. Okay, so let's have a look. So maybe to make it a bit clearer, I also do some new line here. And you see this epsilon is like 10 to the minus 16. So let's have a look. What is 1 plus epsilon? 1 plus epsilon is 1. 1 plus epsilon is 1. So maybe we can again have, so this should be 1 plus epsilon here in the print. Maybe we can have a test 1 plus epsilon equals 1. So what is this? I would like to have a test, and the test in Java is equal equal. So this should be equal equal to 1. So is 1 plus epsilon equal to 1? Yes, this is true. And actually, what is 1 plus 2 epsilon? 1 plus 2 epsilon is different from 1. Okay, and you also see here below how it is different from 1. It is the last digit that makes the difference. Okay, so this was my session on the representation of floating point numbers. And I believe from these two examples with the tiny, yeah, and also with the epsilon, you see that there are certain numbers, and these numbers are not so implausible. 10 to the minus 16. Not such a big, not such a small number. I mean, compared to the numbers which we represent, the smallest possible number is 10 to the minus 300. So, but for certain operation, 10 to the minus 16 is too small. Yeah. So you see that there are certain numbers, certain ranges which cause problems where very basic mathematical rules are violated, like associativity is violated. Okay. And this is actually the root of all evil. And in the next session, I have some small examples where you can find how this strikes us in real applications.